Good evening to one and all. Today, our guest speaker is Dr. Maria Capellini from Italy. She's going to lecture us on thalassemia advances in 2021. This webinar is brought to you by Mumbai Hematology Group, supported by Sun Pharma and managed by Mice Ideas. I'm thankful to Mr. Arvind Suri, Mr. Kanchan Banerjee, Dr. Poonam Rohira and their team from Sun Pharma for supporting our academic activities. Mr. Rajesh Sharma, Mr. Kalpesh Pambar, and the team Mice Ideas for managing all our academic seminars. Executive Committee of Mumbai Hematology Group that gives me free hand to organize these. And of course, our guest speaker, Dr. Maria Capellini from Italy, who has been educating us for thalassemia and uplifting the care of thalassemics in this country for last so many decades. Discussants of today's webinar, who are themselves eminent pediatric and adult hematologists, all of you for spending your Sunday evening. Our guest today is Dr. Colonel A.T.K. Rao, who has been introduced to you already. And our discussants today have again been introduced to you. But just to enumerate them, we have Dr. Rajiv Bansal from Jaipur, Dr. Prashant Hewalkar from Mumbai, Dr. Purva Kanvinde from Mumbai, Dr. Omkar Khankar from Mumbai, Dr. Amit Jain from Mumbai. So now, it's my privilege to introduce Dr. Maria Capellini. She's Professor of Internal Medicine, Department of Clinical Sciences and Community, University of Milan, Italy. For the last 20 years, she is full Professor of Internal Medicine, Department of Clinical Sciences and Community Health, University of Milano. Since 1999, she has been the Chief of Thalassemia and Hemoglobinopathy Center, Milano. She is scientific advisor for the Thalassemia International Federation and contributor to their meetings. She was instrumental in establishing the guidelines for the treatment of thalassemia published by TIF. She has done extensive research in the field of hereditary disorders of red cells, especially, of course, thalassemia. She's an invited speaker and chair for various prestigious meetings all across the globe and various events as well. She was president of European Federation of Internal Medicine. It's a pleasure, ma'am, to have you this afternoon for you and evening for us for once again telling us all about thalassemia in 2021. I'll stop sharing my screen and it's all over to you.
Good afternoon to everybody and thank you for inviting me. Let me just share the screen. Let me see if I can share my screen. Can you see my slide?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm opening full screen. Okay, so thank you very much for giving me this opportunity and thank you, Dr. Agarwal, for this introduction. Last time I was in Mumbai and I enjoy very much to be there. So hopefully next time will be possible to do a face-to-face meeting. So today I'm going to provide you some advances in thalassemia in 2021. These are my disclosure, and this here is the agenda I'm going to follow in this presentation. Very shortly, I will give you an update on pathophysiology and classification of beta thalassemias, few words on conventional treatment, but then I will mainly focus on novel therapies and future development, which is actually the novelties of this 2021. This slide is just to remind you that we are focusing on beta thalassemia due to the fact that the beta globin gene synthesis is controlled by only a single gene on chromosome 11. So two genes are sufficient to give rise a clinical phenotype, whereas the alpha gene are four. So the clinical phenotype require a more complex underlying genotype. That's just to remind you. I start with this presentation reminding you what beta thalassemias are. As you know, are inherited situation due to homozygosity or compound heterozygosity for beta globin gene mutations, or we may have clinical phenotype also in presence of an heterozygous states for the beta globin gene combined with multiple alpha globin gene. This situation leads to alpha and beta globin chain imbalance, and the consequence of this globin chain imbalance is ineffective erythropoiesis in the bone marrow, hemolysis in peripheral circulation, and both, of course, are responsible of chronic anemia of varying severity. This situation is generated in terms of pathophysiology by the red cell pathology, which is a consequence of free alpha globin chain accumulation into erythroblast and the accumulation of the excess unstable alpha globin tetramers damage the red cells. On the other side, this severity of ineffective erythropoiesis and hemolysis may be upon the type of beta mutation severity, because we may have beta zero mutation or beta plus plus mutation. You have to know that we know more than 400 different mutation of the into the beta globin gene, some very severe, some less severe. Moreover, the co-inheritance of alpha thalassemia, as I already mentioned, may play a role. So this slide, which I generated for the review in New England Journal of Medicine, just published recently, try to relate the beta thalassemia phenotype with the different genotypes. So you may have in the top of the slide the different genotype, starting from heterozygosity for silent beta mutation, or heterozygosity for a beta plus mutation, or a beta zero mutation, or a beta E mutation. And in such cases, in both cases, we have the condition of a carrier. So the phenotype is characterized by mild or even absent anemia in case of silent mutation, or microcytic hypochromic almost asymptomatic anemia in case of beta plus or beta zero mutation. When we move on the right side of the slide, we have the combined genotype, and the clinical outcome is relevant, and we may distinguish the thalassemia intermedia and the thalassemia major. So we may have as a genotype combination double heterozygosity for beta plus mutation, or beta E and beta plus mutation, or we may have beta plus beta zero, or beta E beta zero. And in such cases, we have beta thalassemia intermedia. And in such situation, the anemia can be mild to moderate, with clinical evidences, so there are some clinical symptoms. The very extreme is the homozygosity for beta zero mutation, and in such case, we have a beta thalassemia major, and the diagnosis usually is performed before the age of two because the anemia is very severe and the clinical symptoms and signs are evident. So in such a situation, we may have some modifiers, gene such as for example, co-inheriting alpha thalassemia or co-inheriting increased production of gamma globin chain. So looking at this kind of genotype classification and clinical presentation, we thought that especially for those clinicians who are not expert on thalassemia, and they may receive patients from pediatric setting, in adult setting. So for those who are not used to deal with the different genotypes, some years ago, under the supervision of Professor David Weder, a group of experts, and I was among them, decided to simplify the clinical classification based on transfusion requirement. And so far, is very commonly used a clinical classification in non-transfusion dependent thalassemia and transfusion dependent thalassemia. And without going into much details, I just want to keep your attention on the right extreme of this arrow, where the transfusion-dependent thalassemia are allocated, and they include the beta thalassemia major, the severe hemoglobin E beta thalassemia, and although we are not going to discuss that, they include also the hemoglobin BARTS eye drops, which are representing the alpha thalassemia major. On the other extreme, of course, there are the carriers, which already we mentioned are mainly asymptomatic or presenting a mild microcytic anemia. And in between these two extremes, there is a wide spectrum under the definition of non-transfusion dependent thalassemia, including beta thalassemia intermedia, mild to moderate hemoglobin E beta thalassemia, and hemoglobin H disease, which is the equivalent of alpha thalassemia intermedia. Under this definition, as I said, this spectrum is quite heterogeneous because we may have patients who require only seldomly transfusion, patients who may require occasional transfusion in case of specific events such as surgery, pregnancy, infection, and some patients who are requiring intermittent transfusion. So these are patients who are transfused, but differently than those regularly transfused, they may receive bloods every 2 or 3 months. I suggest to download, if you don't have it, the guideline for the Thalassemia International Federation for both conditions, especially because last week the new updated version have been uploaded on TIF website. Very often with this classification, people was asking, but a non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients could become a transfusion dependent thalassemia patients, and vice versa. So just recently with Khaled Moussalam and Professor Taher, we published this paper in American Journal of Hematology just to explain clear that some patients, those who with a non-transfusion dependent thalassemia condition, but requiring maybe transfusion every 2-3 months, getting older, they may complain of the chronic anemia they are suffering of, and they will require a more regular scheme of transfusion. And this usually happen in our experience for those more severe forms of thalassemia intermedia. On the other hand, transfusion dependent patients, they remain transfusion dependent by definition because they cannot improve the clinical status themselves. But the situation in the future could be modified by the novel therapies. So patients who are transfusion dependent, maybe have been transfusion dependent for years, introducing the novel treatment, they may reduce the blood requirement. So this slide is to clarify this point, which could be misleading. One interesting aspect is that more and more we are underlying the role and the importance of the primary care physician, because they may play a key role, especially in identifying those patients with a non-transfusion dependent conditions, which often is considered are considered as affected by a chronic non-serocytic hemolytic anemia, and they actually have an underlying thalassemia intermedia, or anyway, hemoglobin thalassemia. So that is to keep your attention on a strict collaboration of a primary care. Okay, this was the general introduction, and you know that in transfusion-dependent thalassemia, in transfusion-dependent thalassemia, the major burden is the iron overload, which is responsible of morbidity. So in such a, let's say, algorithm where we may identify the consequences of ineffective erythropoiesis and hemolysis, clearly introducing transfusion, we are going to improve the situation. We are reducing anemia and we are reducing the ineffective erythropoiesis, suppressing the bone marrow. But as a real consequence, worsening the clinical outcome is the iron overload, which could be responsible of severe organ damage if we are not entering the proper iron chelation. And I go quickly here just to remind you that transfusion very quickly saturate completely the transferrin. So as a consequence, the non-transferrin bound iron will be free and it will target some susceptible organs such as endocrine organs, heart, liver, pancreas, gonads, and the bones. So it's extremely important to start almost immediately when patients start a regular blood transfusion, start to a proper iron chelation. And I want to again recall your attention to the fact that in naive patients starting to accumulate iron, either by absorption or because of transfusion, first of all, the transfer saturation will complete, the transferrin will be completely saturated, and TBI will be present in plasma. The first organ which will be iron loaded is the liver, and when the excess iron overwhelms hepatocyte capacity, there will be a liver damage, particularly fibrosis, and then can evolve to cirrhosis. But the, after that, it will start an iron leakage, and the hepcidin will be low, and of course that contribute to further systemic iron overload, which affect liver, heart, or endocrine organs. And we know that these are still old number, but are still true, and we may say that when the liver iron concentration is more than 7 mg/g dry weight, there is an increased risk of morbidity and liver disease. And the risk of cardiac disease starts between liver iron concentration of between 7 and 15. But definitely, if the iron concentration is more than 15 mg/g dry weight, we have not only the risk of hepatic fibrosis and cirrhosis, and eventually hepatocellular carcinoma in the elderly patients, but definitely there is an increased risk of cardiac disease. When the T2 star evaluated by MRI at cardiac level is less than 20 milliseconds, patients are exposed to a risk of cardiac arrhythmia. And if the T2 star will be less than 10, there is a clear risk of heart failure. So we try to revisit, let's say, this value. And we may say, we learned that from a cohort of non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients, we may say that even with the liver iron concentration less than 7, some morbidities may be present in such patients. So, as I just mentioned, trying to better understand what is going on in a thalassemia patient out of regular transfusion and regular iron chelation. So based on the pathophysiology of the disease, we look carefully at 584 patients with non-transfusion dependent beta thalassemia for 6 comprehensive centers in Middle East and Italy. You will be surprised that I'm going back to this data published already in 2010, but we are still learning a lot looking back at this data. First of all, selecting from this cohort of patients, 100 beta thalassemia patients treatment naive. So they were not transfused, they were not chelated. And looking at the morbidities, you can see that many, almost all the complications we see in thalassemia patients are observed. And what is interesting is that this complication increase with age. So after the age of 30, you can see that all the complications are present with high frequency, and they increase decade by decade, starting already during the first decade. So the message from this observation is that pathophysiological mechanism underlying thalassemias generate several complications, some of which will be more frequent in transfused patients because are affected also by iron overload, but some of them are related to the pathophysiological mechanism of the thalassemia. And we found that the clinical morbidity in these patients correlate very much with the severity of ineffective erythropoiesis. So using as a marker of ineffective erythropoiesis, although it's not very, very, let's say, specific, but GDF-11 can give us an idea of the ineffective erythropoiesis. And it's clear that the clinical severity score goes with the level of GDF-15. We are now trying to do the same using erythroferrone. So what is the message from this observation? Once again, as much as the ineffective erythropoiesis is remaining, is present in such patients, even in those transfused, if they are not properly transfused, they will cause a morbidities. And moreover, there is the chronic anemia is clearly independently associated with clinical morbidity. So as more anemic these patients are, the highest rate of morbidity is present. And even in this observation, we may pick up some suggestion. When we talk of transfusion-dependent thalassemia patients, often in some countries, the pre-transfusional level of hemoglobin, although the patients are regularly transfused, but they are insufficiently transfused. And if the hemoglobin level is maintained around 8 or even below 8, the residual ineffective erythropoiesis is responsible of different morbidity. And this is a very recent paper. It came out a couple of weeks ago, where in a cohort of patients, according to the level of hemoglobin, you can appreciate the percentage of morbidity-free survival. So the green line represents patients with hemoglobin level maintained equal or more than 10 grams. And you can see that along a follow-up of 10 years, the morbidity-free survival is quite good, whereas in patients with a lower level of hemoglobin, we cut off less than 10, but actually was the majority were less than 9, you can see that morbidity is much worse, and particularly the presence of multi-morbidity. There is no need to underline that if we are not going to properly suppress the ineffective erythropoiesis, the risk is to have extramedullary hematopoietic masses. And that's not only, as I said, we are using NTDT data to understand also what is going on in TDT. in TDT under transfused with my also observed this complication, such as also leg ulcers, which are very rare in properly well transfused patients. Moreover, if we leave a residual ineffective erythropoiesis and a level of hemoglobin chronically, level of hemoglobin less than 8, we are promoting an increased iron absorption. And in such cases, even in absence of transfusion, there is a iron overload due to ineffective erythropoiesis and chronic anemia. As a consequence of that, there is a low level of hepcidin, and several markers are now under evaluation to allow to identify properly the ineffective erythropoiesis level. But the low level of hepcidin implies an increased release of recycled iron from the reticular endothelial system, and this leads to iron overload. And there are several studies showing that iron overload is a major contributor to multiple morbidities, even in non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients. Some things that was clarified just few years ago, because previously I remember that we used to say to the patients, you are not regularly transfused, thus you are not going to accumulate iron, which was really wrong. And also was wrong also because we were dealing with some problem in defining the iron overload threshold in these non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients or in patients with a residual ineffective erythropoiesis. In fact, if you look at the right left side of the slide in the box, there are the serum ferritin levels compared to liver iron concentration. And although in both conditions, thalassemia major and thalassemia intermedia are linear, but you can appreciate that for thalassemia intermedia, for similar level of liver iron concentration compared to thalassemia major, the ferritin level were much low. For example, for a liver iron concentration of 15, you may have a ferritin level less than 1,000 in thalassemia intermedia, whereas in thalassemia major is much higher. So based on that, I'm not going into details because all the data are published, but we come out with the conclusion that serum ferritin values above 800 nanogram per ml in non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients or patients with a very residual ineffective erythropoiesis are associated with a considerable morbidity. Whereas patients with less than 300 most probably have no complication, and the green area, the gray area between 300 and 800 should be monitored for complication. And it was shown that liver iron concentration of more than 5 milligrams is already associated with considerable morbidity. Some other complications should be taken into account when there is a residual ineffective erythropoiesis, such as in non-transfusion dependent thalassemia or in improperly transfused patient, and that is the hypercoagulability and vascular disease, which recognize, of course, several contributors, endothelial injury, microparticles, platelet abnormalities, but definitely an important role is played by the pathologic red blood cells or erythroblasts with precipitated hemochrome, which damage the membrane. There are several studies proving these hypercoagulability states, which is increase and particularly require attention in splenectomized patients. To help in, let's say, predicting, although is not 100% exclusive, but that we try to develop a scoring system for thrombosis, including age, because it was proved that patients more than 35 have high risk, hemoglobin level below 9, serum ferritin above 1,000, irregular transfusion and splenectomy. So that's in terms of some, let's say, focus on some aspect of the pathophysiology. Now, two words, but I don't want to spend time because there is no need for that, on conventional treatment. As you know, transfusion and iron chelation have been the mainstay for therapy in patients with TDT. I already said, transfusion has some advantages, but definitely is worsening something. And iron chelation became essential to improve and ameliorate iron overload. There are masses of data related to iron chelation, and particularly for the oral iron chelation with deferazirox. And I'm not going on that because data are all published. And what I do is just to invite you to look at this review in New England Journal of Medicine, where all this information are published. What is important is to remind you what I already mentioned. Transfusion-dependent thalassemia means that these patients require a regular blood transfusion, and that means every 2 to 5 weeks in order to maintain hemoglobin level above 9, between 9 and 10.5. And that is extremely important, because if a patient drops the hemoglobin and is not allowed to maintain by himself or herself the hemoglobin level, it should be transfused with this maintaining level of pre-transfusional hemoglobin. The average is variable. Vary between patients. There are some patients, a minority, I have to say, among those with severe genotype, who are receiving a low blood, intermediate, and high blood. That was an observation done during the trial for iron chelation. And again, we found some regional variation in transfusion practices, which may impact, as I said, in morbidities and in organ suffering due to residual ineffective erythropoiesis. That's generally is very well defined for transfusion dependent, and again, you can find data on the newly released Thalassemia International Federation guideline. More complicated is the management of iron overload in NTDT patients, and also in relation to the anemia. We don't really have clear cutoff or clear recommendation for treating anemia in such patients. However, we know that, as I mentioned before, the chronic persistent anemia is definitely dangerous. As for the iron overload, you can find much more data related to the trial conducted with the Ferazirox, where we found that this patient actually may have severe iron overload and they may require iron chelation, which anyway cannot be standardized, but has to be, let's say, tailored according to the ferritin level, as I mentioned before. As for the transfusion and correction of anemia, we are still without a clear guideline. We may have some suggestion, and from the clinical trial ongoing with the new molecule, we are going to learn how improving anemia most probably improve quality of life and organ damage in these patients. And actually, even again, from the optimal care study, although data were, let's say, just observational, but they showed that transfusion therapy was protective for thrombosis, for extramedullary hematopoiesis, masses, cholelithiasis, pulmonary hypertension, and so on. But on the other hand, of course, was responsible for iron overload. And this is the recent data collected by Khaled Moussalam from a large registry, where he found that regular transfusion was associated with reduced cause with reduced morbidities and cardiovascular disease related mortality. And the green line are patients regularly transfused and regularly chelated compared to those non regularly transfused. And that's similarly for hepatic disease. So I just want to finish this, let's say, few words on standard treatment, showing that the chelation therapy for patients not regularly transfused are now quite well defined according to the liver iron concentration, or when the liver iron concentration is not available, based on ferritin level, as I mentioned before. More than 800 ferritin level definitely require an initiation of iron chelation. Let's move for the last part to the novel therapies for thalassemia, because these are the novelties in 2021. So we just review the pathophysiology, we review the standard of care, which was mainly focused on suppressing the bone marrow activity and correcting the anemia. But having learned more about pathophysiology and consequences of ineffective erythropoiesis, a lot of effort have been put by many scientists to target some of these pathophysiological mechanisms. And there are three main targets. One is the correction of the alpha-beta globin chain imbalance. And this can be done by gene therapy, genome editing, or hemoglobin F-inducing agents. And we'll go quickly. The second target could be the correction of ineffective erythropoiesis, which is the consequence of the imbalance. And here we have some erythroid maturation agents, PK activators, and some other molecules. And finally, a third target could be the iron homeostasis. I mentioned that in thalassemia, due to the increased iron absorption, modulation of iron distribution, there is a low hepcidin level, and that can be in some way targeted with novel therapy. So let's quickly update on gene therapy. Gene therapy, let's say, is a good theoretical approach for thalassemia, because thalassemia actually has a defect which is affecting the hematopoietic system, and especially the erythropoiesis. So is a defect of the globin chain in the hematopoietic system. Of course, you may complain saying that bone marrow transplantation can do the same, but bone marrow transplantation requires, first of all, a bone marrow donor, and the best result have been achieved with an HLA identical donor. Gene therapy overcome this problem of donor availability and also the immunologic complication associated with bone marrow transplantation. You know the procedure, the stem cells are CD, the stem cells actually are harvested from the patients, sent to a lab, a specific lab where CD34 are purified. And then CD34 positive cells are transduced, introducing the beta globin gene, which is transported by a viral vector, which is a lentiviral vector. In the meantime, patients undergo myeloablation from day -5 to -1, and when the patient is ready and the cryopreserved cells are undergoing a quality control, they are defrosting and sent back to the patients. So it took quite a long time to reach the clinical step for gene therapy. The main issue was to identify the proper viral vectors and also the transduction condition in order to have a high copy number. Nowadays, there are several clinical trials using a lentiglobin BB305 from Bluebird Company. Two have been completed and were phase 1-2 open label study, which allowed, although very small, allowed the registration for treating anemia in beta thalassemia. There are now other study ongoing, phase 3 and one also in children, and they are ongoing, and some data have been already presented at ASH and EHA this year. GLOBE is another clinical trial conducted in Italy from San Raffaele Hospital. It was a phase 1-2, enrolling 10 patients, all transfusion dependent, from childhood to adult life. Now is in standby, is not recruiting because of some agreement with companies. And then there is another phase 1 ongoing trial, but is not recruiting. Data have been published for the phase 1-2 BB305 lentiglobin, and was published in New England. And here is the summary of the results. 22 TDT patients were enrolled. 12 out of 13 who had a non beta-0 genotype became transfusion independent. A 9 patient with beta-0 genotype reduced the blood transfusion annually, but not all discontinued the treatment. And these results, although limited and in a small cohort of patients, allowed the approval of this treatment, gene therapy, with the product which is named Zynteglo, for patients age more than 12 years with a non beta zero beta zero. That was approved in Europe in June 2019. I have to mention that in February, the clinical trial was stopped due to a appearance of acute myeloid leukemia and two myelofibrosis cases in the trial in sickle cell disease. Thalassemia had no problem, thalassemia patients had no problem, but because the vector or the viral vector was the same, the trial was stopped, but just recently the company proved that there was no relationship with the gene therapy, so the trial is restarted. And these are the results in the GLOBE trial, showing again that the better responders are the non-beta-zero-beta-zero patients, and particularly the better responder are children. So that is the situation for non-transfusion, gene therapy. So the additional gene therapy, the gene therapy where the beta globin, the missing or non-functioning beta globin gene is added to the stem cells. But there is another possibility of correcting the globin chain imbalance, and that is through an increase of gamma globin chain production. And this is based on many data, either in proving that patients inheriting hereditary persistence of fetal hemoglobin, they may improve their clinical outcome, but also there are many data proving that drugs with a methylation effect may increase the gamma globin production and improve the hemoglobin F level. But those pharmacological approaches were, let's say, unsuccessful because of a poor response, absence of prospective clinical trial, side effect, and so on. So things change with the possibility of controlling at molecular level the hemoglobin F production, and that can be done using the gene editing approach. We know that BCL11A is involved physiologically in suppressing the fetal hemoglobin. So in theory, deleting or modifying the function of BCL11 is possible to prevent the expression of BCL11, leading to increased production of fetal hemoglobin in the hematopoietic stem cells. And this can be done actually using, for example, CRISPR-Cas9 gene editing, which is an approach quite well established now in several conditions. And there are definitely one trial, the ST400 is actually not recruiting, but the CTX001 or CLIMB TAL101, which is a phase 1-2 trial addressing 45 transfusion-dependent thalassemia patients with no HLA match donor, because of course in such case the priority was for bone marrow transplantation. And this is definitely very, very promising. The procedure is very similar to that of gene addition. The difference is that the stem cells are corrected, let's say, manipulated with CRISPR-Cas instead of adding the gene, but the procedure is the same. And these are the interim results from 5 patients published in New England Journal of Medicine in December, in parallel to the presentation at ASH, showing clearly that these patients had a good engraftment and ceased receiving transfusion soon after the product infusion, with the last transfusion occurring between 0.9 and 1.9 months after the infusion. And back to at that time, so the last December, the first patients who received the product remained transfusion-free for over 15 months and now are more than 21 months. So this was really, really very promising. And DHA this year, more data consisting and similar to those were presented. There is another approach, which is this molecule, IMR-687, which is an inhibitor of phosphodiesterase 9, which mediates cellular signaling pathway by degrading GMP, and it's inactivated hormone phosphate 4. So inhibiting PDE9, this molecule increases intracellular GMP levels and stimulates the production of fetal hemoglobin. We don't have data on that yet. The trial is ongoing and recruiting. Let's move to the second target, which is definitely interesting, and that is targeting ineffective erythropoiesis. And I go straight to luspatercept, which is so far the only molecule registered for treating anemia in transfusion-dependent thalassemia patients. Luspatercept is an erythroid maturation agent that neutralizes select TGF-beta superfamily ligands and inhibits SMAD2, SMAD3 signaling and enhances erythroid maturation. So I go quickly because since the beginning, few years ago with a phase 2 study, now there are completed phase 3 study and for non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients also a completed phase 2 study. So just to let you know, the phase 2, which was more explorative, performed either with luspatercept or sotatercept, which is a sister molecule, in a small cohort, including 33 non-transfusion-dependent thalassemia patients and 31 transfusion-dependent, it was observed that 58% of NTDT patients increase hemoglobin of more than 1.5 gram, and 81% of TDT patients reduce the transfusion burden of more than 20%. Of course, I have to remind you that the drug is given subcutaneously every 3 weeks. And in your right side, you can see an improvement of legs ulcer in patients treated. So the result of the phase 2 allowed the design of a BELIEVE study, a phase 3 randomized double-blind placebo control in adult patients with TDT. Randomized 2-to-1. Now the study, of course, was unblinded after 48 weeks and is in a follow-up. So data have been published. I remind you that the primary endpoint was a reduction of transfusion burden equal or more than 33% from baseline during a fixed period between week 13 and 24. And this primary endpoint was clearly achieved in the luspatercept cohort. And even interesting was that the subgroup analysis were all in favor of luspatercept. All the secondary endpoints also were observed. And the secondary endpoint was a reduction of equal or more than 33% in another fixed period during the 48 weeks, or equal or more than 50% in the two similar weeks interval. And all the secondary endpoint were statistically achieved. But what is more important to me, and I want to stress that, is the reduction of 33% or more than 50% at any 12-week interval or at any 24-week interval. And that's why, because these patients, as I tried to explain in my first part of the presentation, they don't have the similar level of ineffective erythropoiesis. They have different level of ineffective erythropoiesis. So the time response can be different. And looking to the result in this way, you can see that 70% of the patient achieve a reduction of more than 33%. In terms of safety, I don't want to spend too much time because nothing was really serious. And at least in the luspatercept cohort, some patients complain at the beginning of treatment, some bone pain, arthralgia, or dizziness, but all were manageable. I want to conclude the luspatercept showing these ancillary results on iron overload and iron chelation therapy. It's interesting to see that patients starting at baseline with serum ferritin above 1,000 at after 48 weeks or even more, they actually move a high percentage, more than 57%, move from more than 1,000 to less than 1,000 ferritin value. And similarly for patients who started with serum ferritin above 2,500 and post-baseline, they reduce the level of ferritin. And similarly, although it takes a bit longer, we are observing a reduction on liver iron concentration and myocardial iron. So these results lead to approval of luspatercept by FDA in 2019 and by EMA in 2020 to treat anemia in adult patients with beta thalassemia who require regular blood transfusion. Now, the luspatercept will be available in real life, and hopefully we are collecting and getting more data to easily use these compounds. These are data which I show for the first time. They've been presented by Professor Taher at the Presidential Symposium at EHA and show the results of phase two in adult patients with NTDT, is the Beyond trial. And here the primary endpoint was the achievement of more than 1 gram of hemoglobin from baseline over a continuous 12-week interval during week 13-24. And this key secondary endpoint was the mean change of the NTDT PRO. The results have been, the primary endpoint have been achieved. 77% of patients versus zero placebo achieved increase of hemoglobin level. And during week 13-24, 52% patients in luspatercept arm achieve a minimum globin increase of more than 1.5 gram. And in terms of patients' report outcome, a specific tool was developed for NTDT and particular tiredness and weakness were evaluated in these patients. And it's interesting to note that the tiredness and the weakness domain score correlate with the hemoglobin increase, proving that the increase of hemoglobin impact on quality of life. That's for luspatercept. What else do we have? Mitapivat. Mitapivat is a first-in-class oral small molecule activator of pyruvate kinase, has been shown already to be effective in patients with PK deficiency. And in thalassemia mouse model showed reduced marker of ineffective erythropoiesis and improved anemia, RBC survival, and indexes of iron overload. There is a phase two ongoing trial and phase three, not yet recruiting, but already approved, and the recruitment will start soon. And they include either non-transfusion dependent or transfusion dependent patients. And these are interim data from phase two trial showing clearly that in a small cohort of patients, of course, but almost 100%, because 8 out of 9 patients achieve the endpoint of increasing hemoglobin more than 1 gram. What else in terms of targeting ineffective erythropoiesis? There were two molecules which were considered the potential drug. One is a JAK inhibitor, ruxolitinib, but the clinical trial was concluded in transfusion-dependent thalassemia patients, and the only effect was a reduction of spleen volume. And the other one is bitopertin, which is a glycine receptor inhibitor, but that was prematurely terminated because of no efficacy and side effects. So to my knowledge, these two compounds have no further development. I have the two last slides on therapy in targeting the iron homeostasis. And here, one possibility is to stimulate the hepcidin production, having considered that we have low hepcidin. One is Tempura 6, and one is a product of from Silence, which is a RNA interfering interference also acting on Tempura 6. And they are just recruiting and starting the phase two. Another molecule is the ferroportin inhibitor. Even this one is recruiting, and it seems to be efficacious based on data in mouse model. Other hepcidin mimetics molecules were started in clinical trial, but they have been stopped for no efficacy and some side effect, and there are no data for further development. So I hope that with these new novel therapies, we may integrate either gene therapy or pharmacological treatment into the standard of care that I try to summarize in this algorithm, which you can find on the New England Journal of Medicine review. And even more interesting for the non-transfusion dependent thalassemia patients, looking at the future, whenever the data will be available for the single molecule, we may think to combination treatment. And with that, I would like to thank patients, families, colleagues around the world, the nurses, and of course, my team in Milan. And I thank you all for listening.
Thank you so much, Professor Cappellini. That was a very educational lecture. You updated us on various things that are happening in the field of thalassemia in the last 5 years. So we have Indian faculty here who would like to interact with you. We also have audience, and they would like to ask some questions to you. And I'd like to begin with my friend, Dr. A.T.K. Rao. Unmute yourself, Dr.
Rao.
Thank you, Professor Cappellini. That was absolutely fabulous. I've been an ardent fan of your work for the last 30 years or so, and been reading each one of your papers. Thank you for this very informative talk. I have just one question, which may appear to be a little silly, but I would like to know why hydroxyurea does not work in thalassemia intermedia and in NDT thalassemia.
Yeah. This is not trivial. It's a very important question. And I don't have let's say, definitive answer. First of all, we are missing data with hydroxyurea because for many reasons, we don't have a prospective clinical trial, but we have sporadic reports of a small cohort of patients. The only real data are from the Iranian, maybe also some from India, but there are really some discrepancies because I treated some thalassemia patients, mainly non-transfusion dependent, and I never observed increase of hemoglobin, which is what we want to see. What I do with hydroxyurea in these patients is to prescribe hydroxyurea whenever there are extramedullary hematopoiesis masses. In this condition, I really saw a significant effect on the development and increasing of these masses, even without an increase of hemoglobin. Why? Probably, and that is, I'm thinking aloud, probably alone is not sufficient to correct the ineffective erythropoiesis. I am thinking to the possibility of a combination in the future of hydroxyurea with one of the other molecules. So I think that is still a molecule, let's say, on the table, which should or could be considered in combination.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Rao. We'll take a question from the audience. Question from Dr. Rahman. How do you manage patients of alloimmunized thalassemia?
Sorry, how I manage?
Alloimmunized thalassemics who have developed antibodies.
Okay, immunized, you mean? Immunized.
That's
the cases where I use hydroxyurea as well. It's the only way to... let's say, keep the hemoglobin level, not increasing, but at least at an acceptable level. And this is a condition where I use 20 milligram per kg of hydroxyurea.
Right. We go to Dr. Rajiv Bansal. Your question, Rajiv.
Presentation. We in India have been using combination of the two oral RL chelators. What the dosages you are using in combination at your end? And are you still keeping 1,000 as a standard? Where, in fact, in my own practice now, I've come down to 500 and finding better results in young children so they get their secondary sexual characters at the right time. In fact, in my own practice, I try and decrease only if things are going below 500 or maybe up to sometime up to 250, 300, what any side effects going low, very low?
Okay, first question was on combination, correct? Combination treatment of the two oral, you mean? So the combination, the common, the standard combination is deferoxamine, deferiprone, or deferoxamine, deferazirox. We are now using quite frequently the combination with deferazirox, because in several occasions the deferiprone was responsible of neutropenia and so on. So in that case, I'm using the combination treatment when there is a real need. So if there is a real need, I do the real combination. So 5 days the deferoxamine and 7 days the deferazirox. I'm not using the alternative or things like that. I prefer to be intensive, maybe for 2-3 months, and then to go back to monotherapy. For the dosage of the deferiprone, if possible, usually we are using 75 milligram per kg, but in some cases also 100 milligram per kg. And the second question was how low we can keep the ferritin. Is that correct? Well, we published a few months ago a paper showing that even going below 500 ferritin level and keeping around 300, we are safe. So without toxicity or side effect due to overchelation. Of course, it has to be, let's say, evaluated patient by patient, because some patients already have some consequences of an overchelation back in the past. But we are not, let's say, 500 is not the cutoff which I'm using. I go lower than that.
Thank you. I will take one more question from the audience. Have you seen leg ulcers following use of hydroxyurea?
No, not personally, but there are cases reported in the literature. And that is also a controversy, because there are some reports where leg ulcers were, let's say, ameliorated by hydroxyurea and vice versa. What is the explanation? I don't really know. I believe that it should be something also local, due maybe to endothelial situation, maybe to secondary Adams 13 lac and so on. But I mean, that's the real world. Few cases benefit, some other worsen. So you have to try with your patient and see what is going on.
Thank you. Dr. Prashant, your question.
Thank you for fantastic lecture, Professor Capellani. My question is regarding transplantation. Do you have an algorithm for referring thalassemia patient for transplantation? For example, a 10-year-old boy with no HLA match donor, well transfused, well chelated, without iron overload, would you consider referring this patient for haplotransplantation?
I'm dealing with adult patients, so let's say from 18 to above. And for those, let's say, adult patients, actually, those who could have been transplanted, they were transplanted. And few of them are asking for an haploidentical or even cord blood. But these days, I mean, we are not particularly in favor of this choice. In childhood, the story is different. As you suggested for your case, a 10-year-old boy. Now, if you look at the algorithm, this kind of child could be candidate for gene therapy. But of course, gene therapy is not yet available and the cost so far is prohibitive. So if the family is compliant and the child is compliant, in a good clinical status, it can be candidate for an alternative bone marrow transplantation donor, not having an HLA identity. It depends very much also on the practice of the center, so how much the center is experienced in using alternative bone marrow sources. But it can be. On the other hand, the scenario nowadays is open. My question to you, what do you feel to treat now? We are starting from the age of 12, but there will be a pediatric trial. How would you consider treating this patient with luspatercept, if the luspatercept will be available for children?
Yeah, I think it would be worth trying luspatercept for such patients.
I think that I personally will do. So let's say in this way, we are trying to draft an algorithm. Let's say I have a bone marrow transplantation, an HLA identical bone marrow transplantation. This will be the first choice. That's even for gene editing is required. If there is no an HLA identical donor, personally, I will probably start to consider the pharmacological treatment, which may be the patient may be a responder or maybe not a responder, we don't know, but still, I have in my hand the possibility of offering an alternative, whereas doing gene therapy or genome editing, if it fails, then it will be a bit more difficult to get further expectation with the pharmacological treatment. We need to collect data, but that so far is my scenario, let's say.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll take one more question from the audience. If a patient develops hemolysis and hemoglobinuria following blood transfusion, how do you investigate this child? And do you treat with steroids? And do you treat with rituximab, etc.?
If the patient is developing
hemolysis after blood transfusion.
Okay. Well, it depends if it is a reaction to blood transfusion. In such case, you may need steroids. Related to rituximab, actually, it depends. There are some cases reported in the literature where the treatment is effective. But again, it's not a standard of care. You have to look and to evaluate patients by patients.
Thank you. Dr. Amit, your question. Unmute yourself, Amit.
Thank you, Dr. Capellini. It was a wonderful talk. Always pleasure listening to you. So my question is your experience with partial splenectomy or embolization in patients with thalassemia with hypersplenism, but difficult to manage with hypertransfusion and hydroxyurea?
This is a very good question. I don't have personal experience because our surgeons are not really in favor of this approach. In Italy, there are one or two centers that have experience on that. In terms of surgical, let's say, techniques, is not exposing to major risk. The point is that spleen regenerate very quickly. So a partial splenectomy could be a temporary solution. It's not definitive. It can be good for some years. If you have a situation with a hypersplenism and huge volume of the spleen, nowadays a suggestion could be the use of JAK inhibitor, because it's been shown that ruxolitinib, and data have been published, I think the first name is Yashim Aydinok or Taher, I don't remember, in blood, showing that you can really observe a spleen volume reduction and a reduction of hypersplenism. So I already did this approach in a patient who had a huge spleen with some risk performing surgery. So we treat with ruxolitinib for I don't remember exactly how long, and then the patient was addressed to surgery, which was much, much easier to perform and free of risk. So that can be an alternative instead of partial splenectomy. But I don't have personal experience. There are data in literature.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Amit. Dr. Shruti Kakkar from the audience wants to know, are there patients treated with luspatercept who have become totally free from transfusion?
Yeah, that is a good question, because as a secondary endpoints, we said achieving equal or more than 50% reduction from baseline. More than 50% could be 60, 70, 80, 90. And in the cohort of BELIEVE, we had 11 patients who became totally transfusion free. And they are still transfusion free after during follow-up. So yes, that's possible. And I take this opportunity to add a message. During EHA, Dr. Piga presented an oral presentation showing that patients who didn't achieve the primary endpoint at week 48, during the follow-up, because now we are already at week 78 or more, they achieve the primary endpoint and some of them achieve more than 50%. So the message I want to pass is that be patient. This is the concept. Not stop or consider non-responder a patient who is not achieving the reduction at week 13, but keep on going because you may see further response.
Thank you. Another question is whether this happens only to NTDT or even those who are transfusion dependent.
Well, related to what?
Freedom from transfusion after luspatercept.
The non-transfusion dependent, actually they are not on regular transfusion. So the end point is the increase of hemoglobin. Nevertheless, there are, I don't remember exactly the number because we are elaborating the results in these days, but there are some patients who were occasionally transfused and they became transfusion free.
Thank you. Dr. A.T.K. Rao.
Professor Capellini, in the context of COVID-19 and this pandemic, are children who have contracted COVID-19, are they more prone to thrombosis. Have you any experience with that?
Should we put
aspirin, prophylactic aspirin?
This is an interesting question. We actually run a registry in Italy for the thalassemia patients getting the COVID-19, because at the beginning, especially last year with the first wave, we were very surprised because our thalassemia patients were COVID-free. It's true that we gave them all the roles and so, but even after, those who got the COVID had a very mild course, even those splenectomized. So in our Italian experience, it wasn't a serious problem, the COVID infection in thalassemia. Was a little bit more serious in sickle cell disease. A few sickle cells underwent through pulmonary distress. And I think that all together means the Italian registry so far, we had very few deaths, all in sickle cell, not in thalassemia. So we are not using any prophylaxis, but all the protective measures.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll take one question from audience. Dr. Babita wants to know, is luspatercept licensed for pediatric patients?
Not yet. As I said, is licensed from the age of 12. There is a pediatric trial who was already enrolling beginning of February last year, then was stopped due to pandemia. To my knowledge, will be restarted soon for enrollment and hopefully will not be too long for the results.
Thank you. Dr. Rajiv, you have any questions?
Patients of thalassemia, I mean, poorly chelated, who had diabetic ketoacidosis at this time with COVID-19. So this was something which was very different which we observed. The other thing is, in contact with what Dr. Rao said, should we recommend aspirin with Covishield vaccine?
I missed the voice. Should be recommended aspirin or
for vaccination, especially with Covishield.
Well, I tell you that for vaccination, we suggest to take paracetamol. That's what we ask. The risk of thrombosis. I discussed this with my coagulation colleagues. Actually, those who had problem had some coagulation abnormalities background. So, aspirin can be given without consequences. Although I'm not sure that is the protective way in case of a thrombotic event. In Italy, there was a case 1 month ago, more or less, of an 18-year-old girl who had a serious thrombotic events, a stroke, and then pulmonary hypertension, and she died. But then it came out that she had an underlying coagulation disorders, which was known to her and the family, but they didn't mention when she was getting the vaccination. So, you know, that's probably is casualty, but it may happen.
Another question is, if a patient had neutropenia, deferiprone, and Now the patient, this more than 5 or 7 years back, she had dipyrrhopurone and neutropenia. Now the patient is intolerant to deferoxirox, and desferrioxamine is not affordable in this part of the country. So
you can try again.
With lower dosages?
Yeah, we can. You can re-challenge with low doses. And if nothing is going wrong, you can go up to the right dosage. Although the neutropenia may occur anytime during treatment. So in such case, you have to inform the patients, telling to stop whenever he or she has fever, to call the center, you know, all these recommendations. But if there are no alternative, I will try to re-challenge.
Any data on that available, or no data is available?
No, I think that many groups have experience on that, but I don't have in mind any paper specifically.
So what's your hunch? How many percentage of people will ultimately accept the reintroduction?
How many people you mean, patients? Well, I had a single case out of all my cohort of more than 300 patients, and he accepted it is always difficult to prove, but he was complaining that he couldn't take the deferoxirox, he couldn't take the desferrioxamine. So we re-challenged with the dipyrrhopurone, and it was doing well. But then I come to my mind, last year actually, we suggest when the deferoxirox coated the tablet were made available, we proposed to him to move to the deferoxirox coated tablet, and now he's taking that and tolerate, especially dividing the dose half in the morning, half in the evening, and it's going very well with the deferoxirox coated tablet. I have to charge my computer, sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. Question from the audience. How effective are ferroportin inhibitors?
How it works?
How effective are ferroportin inhibitors? Efficacy?
There are preliminary data in animal models and in a phase one. The point is that if you are inhibiting ferroportin, ferroportin is a kind of receptor for hepcidin. So if you are inhibiting ferroportin, you are going to increase hepcidin, which is the final objective in this iron homeostasis modulation. We need to have data because in animal models, through this mechanism of targeting iron homeostasis, you may have effect also on erythropoiesis. You are going to generate a iron-free erythropoiesis, which improves the ineffective erythropoiesis. Personally, and that's also my personal consideration, I'm a bit skeptical that this approach could be effective in monotherapy in terms of ineffective erythropoiesis. I believe that whenever we will have more data available, luspatercept remain the driver, and then we may use, according to the different situation, either metapivat or these iron regulator molecules. Let me put the plug.
Okay, Dr. Prashant.
My question is about pre-transplant preparation of patients with iron overload. Do you try and get the iron overload below a certain limit before you put them to transplant?
This is suggested by the results, not only in thalassemia, but there are papers showing that, for example, for leukemia, if you have severely iron loaded patients, the outcome is much better if you are, let's say, performing an intensive iron chelation before transplantation. For thalassemia, all the data from the Pesaro group support this hypothesis. So if you have a patient with severe iron overload, he or she is a good candidate for bone marrow transplantation. I think it will be the same for gene therapy, by the way. I suggest to perform an intensive chelation period before performing the BMT or gene therapy. And that can be done in because you need not too much delay, you may use a combination treatment in such cases.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant. There are a couple of questions about thalidomide. Is there any now good data available?
Sporadic cases. I was consulted for was a sickle cell disease patient. But there are sporadic reports. I don't feel very confident on using thalidomide, although thalidomide is becoming one of the rescue molecule in onco-hematology. But the mechanism should be similar to that of hydroxyurea. So in case I will start with hydroxyurea first.
Right. Dr. Amit, you have a question?
So, ma'am, we have 2-3 patients of transfusion-dependent thalassemia in 20s and 30s with moderate to severe iron overload in heart and liver, developed pancytopenia. We have ruled out causes like nutrition, infection, and hypersplenism. But we did marrow, which showed iron overload in the marrow. So how would you approach these patients and how effective are these chelating agents in removing iron from marrow?
But are they under chelation or not?
Yes, what they are.
Well, are they compliant? Because, it depends if they are compliant or not, because if you do, if they have such a severe iron overload in the heart, in the liver, definitely I will treat them with a combination, possibly desferal and deferazirox or desferal and deferiprone. That is the only way, is the only possibility you have. I don't see other possibilities.
Your take on
make sure that the patient is compliant, because sometimes they say they take the drug and they don't.
Ma'am, your take on triple chelation therapy, ma'am?
Sorry?
Ma'am, triple chelation therapy, ma'am?
Triple chelation therapy. I don't think it's done by anyone so far. I will have some concern. There are few sporadic cases using the two oral if the patient is not compliant with desferal, but three, I will not be confident using them.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Another question from audience. Dr. Christopher wants to know, in an anti-DT, if the ferritin has come down to 300, now what will be the role of iron chelation? You will reduce it or you will stop it?
If the patient is not under transfusion, you stop it. This, thank you for this question, because I think it's important to underline that the, let's say, design of iron chelation in non-transfusion-dependent thalassemia patient is different than in transfusion-dependent, because in transfusion-dependent, with transfusion, we keep giving iron to the patient. So you have to go on with the chelation therapy. But in non-transfusion dependent, what we do is to start whenever we establish that the patient is iron loaded. And unfortunately, in my patients age 30, 40, all of them, we are discovering that are severely iron loaded. So we start chelation, but we keep monitoring them. And when ferritin reach 300, we stop. And then if the patient is not transfused, it will take a while to reaccumulate iron. So we keep monitoring ferritin, if possible MRI, but maybe they can have even months without chelation.
He has another question about luspatercept. How long should you continue luspatercept before declaring that it is not working?
That's what I mentioned before. We had patients who start to respond after 1 year or even more. So we are trying to identify, and hopefully we will be able to make available some predictor factors. So far we don't have, I mean, genotype could be, but it's not sufficient and so on. So at least I suggest to go over for 48 weeks or more before saying it's not responding.
Thank you. Dr. Rao, you have another question?
You're mute.
Unmute yourself.
Professor Capellani, is there any role of the zinc molecule as far as the bone marrow response?
I don't know. So far, I don't know. We don't have data on that. But thank you. We may consider.
No, we had these two children whom were aggressively chelated. And they had significant low levels of zinc, mm-hmm. and they went into pancytopenia. Mm. We couldn't make out what the cause was, and then we just started them on zinc because the zinc levels.
You supported with zinc.
Yes, and the marrow recovered.
Yes, it could be.
We couldn't explain that.
It could be. Yeah.
Thank you. There is a question about bisphosphonates, zoledronic acid. Do you use it, doses, yes, and schedule?
Well, it's my endocrinologist who does the prescription. We use both, and it depends to choose for bisphosphonate or hyaluronic acid, it depends on case by case. We, before using bisphosphonate, we make sure that patients have no problem of, how you said, necrosis of, because many thalassemia patients have problem with their teeth, so we are very careful on using bisphosphonate. In some cases, we do using the schedule used for normal population.
Thank you. Another question is from Dr. Alka. Between the MRI of liver and serum ferritin, which one do you trust for iron overload?
Ferritin is cost effective is quite available everywhere. Of course, you have to take into account that ferritin is a protein of inflammation also. So if there is any intercurrent inflammatory status, the ferritin level may be affected. And for this reason, you cannot rely in a single fair, maybe ferritin suddenly goes up. So you have to keep a trend. If MRI is available, of course, at least once is good to have it. But we are not performing MRI every year, not at all. Some patients have it, and my patients are adult. In children, I don't see the reason of performing MRI if ferritin can be properly monitored.
Thank you. Dr. Rajiv, any question?
Especially in patients who have been diagnosed beyond 2 or 3 years of age, if a patient comes late, say, in our settings, sometimes patients present very late. This child, I've got a family with E-beta thalassemia, and they're presenting at around 8 or 9 years, which is huge splenohepatomegaly with hemoglobin not going beyond 5 or 6. Should I keep them on regular transfusion for some time, give them hydroxyurea, and then we take them off of the transfusion after some time, or should I continue?
Yeah, these are the patients seen mainly in Thailand, and rely on publication of Dr. Viprakasit. Actually, he's suggesting to keep under transfusion these patients, this kind of patient you mentioned. And he published, I think, data on soft landing of transfusions. So when the patients achieve puberty, they are in an adolescent or young adult phase, they may reduce the blood transfusion. But if they come at the age of 5, 6, or 8, with such a level of hemoglobin, is absolutely right to transfuse them. And as soon as you start, the better, of course.
Thank you. There's one question from the audience about, after you have achieved the maximum height, can you reduce the goal of maintaining hemoglobin at a particular level?
No. It depends, once again, it depends if the patient has a severe genotype and is not able, due to the severe genotype, is not able to produce hemoglobin, you have to keep on going with a regular transfusional regimen. Your consideration could be, but it's not always applicable, it could be right if you have a patient who, as the Dr. Rajiv said, I mean, is a patient who may have a milder genotype, but with severe anemia and started to be transfused, when he's achieving a growth and proper weight and height, you may reduce the transfusion regimen and keeping the patients with an hemoglobin between 8.5, 9.5. But again, I think that the driver of the decision is the residual of ineffective erythropoiesis. What we learn during these years is that, and that was very informative, the study of the optimal care. We learned that if you leave an amount of ineffective erythropoiesis, this is dangerous in any case. So the idea is to keep ineffective erythropoiesis at lower level possible.
Thank you, Dr. Prashant.
What is your practice of reducing iron overload after successful transplantation? do you prefer a regular phlebotomy or do you continue ion chelating agents?
At the beginning, I was discussing with Dr. Angelucci this point because I had some, let's say, concern doing phlebotomy in a patient who has been transplanted. Then I was convinced that is the right way. So I don't have cases now, but if it happen, we go through phlebotomy now.
Thank you.
Thank you. Another question from audience is, do you cross the dose of 40 milligram per kg of deferrasirox? Do you go above that?
Above 40, no. I never suggest to go above 40 milligram per kg, but in severely loaded patients, I can go up to 40. And maybe nowadays, and there are also some reports that you can split the dose after in the morning and after in the evening, but no above 40.
Another question is about...
And of course, sorry, I don't know if you have the coated tablet available now.
We have.
Do you? So in that case, the dosage has to be adapted. So it's not 40 milligram per kg, but is 20... What is 28? I don't remember. So, but has to be considered the difference.
Is the film coated tablet more effective?
It's not. It's not more effective. The content is the same. The results are better because the complete dose is taken. We did this evaluation. When the tablet were dissolved in water, a residual amount of dissolved drug remain in the bottom of the glass. And if the patient was not careful in washing, taking, and so on, there was a residual amount. So probably if I was prescribing 30, the amount taken was probably 25 or something like that. With the pills, this doesn't occur because all is taken and absorbed.
There's a question about ion chelation during pregnancy and lactation.
Well, this is well known. With any type of chelation, is convenient to stop at least during the first and second trimester. And for those pregnant women who have a very severe iron overload, some chelation and preferentially with Desferal can be done during the third trimester, but during the first and second is convenient to stop.
Second is about lactation.
They can restart, but the only data available are on the sferioxamine, to my knowledge.
Right. Any more questions from the faculty here? We are finished with the audience question.
So I just want your comment on Indian patients normally don't respond to, maybe they are more iron overloaded, 20 or 25 doesn't work. I don't know what the experience with Professor Agarwal and Dr. Rao sir is, but majority of them need more than 30 or maybe. And you need to have a combo therapy. And it's working wonders, at least in our setting, maybe the compliance or some other issues, I don't know exactly. We need to do a study on that.
Yeah, the voice was partly frozen, but one of the reasons is that probably they have severe iron load or their compliance is not really as they report. But I know that you need to go up. But it was similar in Middle East. And then it turned out that that when they really took the drug, they respond. But starting, they needed to start with higher doses, 30 or even 40.
Thank you. Any other question, please? And if not, then Dr. Capellini, thank you very much. It has been a wonderful session. You educated us quite a bit and answered all the questions and so many new things in the field of thalassemia you brought us. We have Dr. Poonam Rohira from Sun Pharma to deliver the official vote of thanks. And I may tell you, Dr. Capellini, we have generic FCT, the film-coated preparation, which Sun Pharma is making from last few years. So that is making it cost-effective also for us.
So thank you, Professor Agarwal. We must admit that today's webinar was truly a feast of scientific deliberations on the thalassemia advances. For this, on behalf of Sun Oncology, we would like to thank the Mumbai Hematology Group and Dr. M.B. Agarwal for organizing such an informative and updated webinar. We thank our guest speaker, Dr. Capellini, for the excellent talk on the subject. And it was indeed time well spent for the kind of in-depth knowledge many of us have gained today. We would also like to thank our chief guest, Dr. A.T.K. Rao, for taking us through the webinar today, sharing his experience at the Heights during his duty one of his case he presented today morning. And indeed, sir, it was a pleasure and honor for us to have you as the chair for this webinar. We also thank our discussants, Dr. Rajiv, Dr. Prashant, and Dr. Amit for the excellent Q&A-based discussions on the topic today. Overall, a big thank you to all the delegates for being a part of this session today. We at Sun Pharma, as Dr. M.B. Agarwal mentioned, are associated with your thalassemia patient journey through Defriget and Defriget FCT, which is our brand of Defracerox DT and film-coated tablets. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe and good night.
I would like to thank you also, all of you, for inviting me. And I hope next time to visit you again in Mumbai.
Thank you so much, Professor Capellini. Thank you.